Greetings, I am Mr. Foreman.
And I'm Summer Wilms. This adventure, you'll find us deep in the middle of a massive swamp called the Everglades here in southern Florida.
Florida is a rather graphic appendage dangling from the southeast corner of the United States. Tropical summer storms feed a massive watershed that oozes across the swampy landscape, that is, the Everglades. Ultimately, these waters gurgle out into the Gulf of Mexico. Our proposed route vaguely follows what's called the Wilderness Waterway, a twisting maze of rivers, channels, and bays to the remote outpost of Flamingo.
We're starting here in Everglades City, the northern terminus for this adventure, a 100-plus-mile journey that's going to take us to the southernmost part of mainland U.S. We're trading in horsepower for manpower this episode and venturing into the largest subtropical wilderness in North America.
Planning a trip like this requires overcoming a few logistical hurdles. Luckily, outfitters in the region will, for a price, solve the majority of these issues.
We were unable to find any public transportation either to Everglades City or Flamingo, so as car hire is quite reasonable, we just rented a vehicle from the airport and had it on standby for the entire time.
The next problem is how to get back from Flamingo to where we left the car. We're using the Ivy House in Everglades City that not only hires out all the equipment, but arranges pickups and drop-offs.
Don't be fooled by the term city. This quaint little town is quite small. You'd have a better selection of supplies from some of the larger towns before arriving here. They do have the essentials, beer, accommodation, and food. And there are plenty of churches here, if you're a little concerned about the expedition ahead.
Well, we are packed and seemingly ready to go with our... How many gallons of water do we have?
22?
22 gallons of water in raccoon-proof containers and a box of food and various other paraphernalia.
Departing the Gulf Coast Visitor Center and Ranger Station, we venture out into the waters. We begin by crossing under the bridge to Chokoloskee Key to follow that channel down to the Turner River. Our weather radio has declared a five-day forecast of sunny perfection with a refreshing tailwind in the afternoon. What more could we ask for?
The majority of the time spent following this route is in an estuarine environment surrounded by an impenetrable forest of twisted mangroves embedded in deep, sticky mud. Access to dry land is rare, and all fresh water will need to be carried for the entire journey. It's recommended we carry a gallon for each person per day, in hard-sided containers that prevent raccoons and rats from chewing through.
If that sounds rough, consider the dream of a refreshing dip getting crushed at the revelation of who our new neighbors are. By all accounts, alligators are not ferocious man-eaters, but swimming in these murky waters could be tempting fate. In addition, a larger, though more elusive reptile lurks amongst the mangroves. The American crocodile is slowly rebuilding their numbers after suffering hunting and habitat loss. The Everglades is the only place on Earth where crocodiles and alligators coexist. Although alligators are classified as inhabiting freshwater and crocodiles being in salt, our personal observation showed that these are more of a loose preference.
With fishing having such potential, the waterways are a popular spot for recreational fishermen, so the paddler will encounter a lot of motorboats, especially on the weekends near Flamingo or Everglades City. The region is quite hazardous for any vessel. Good navigational systems and knowledge are helpful. The murky waters conceal hidden oyster beds and shallow areas where even a canoe can become grounded.
And my Daisy Dukes, you guys are in luck.
While on the Wilderness Waterway, you have the benefit of following markers, such as this one. There are 128 from Flamingo.
After about 10 miles, we reach our campsite. Two platforms with a conspicuous big blue thunderbox. Being in first means shifting to the other platform to avoid the smell of the dunny.
This little dock to nowhere is called a chicky, and because there's so many places here in the Everglades that have nothing but tangles of mangroves, this is where we get to pitch our tent, so this is home for the night.
A freestanding tent is obviously essential, as well as campsite bookings made 24 hours in advance at the park headquarters before your trip begins.
Sunset is when the beauty of the Everglades truly shines. And it's also when the nastier side of Mother Nature reveals herself. The swarms of doom emerge from their daytime roosts and begin their quest for blood. Long sleeves, long pants, plenty of repellent are non-negotiable. And one must be prepared for long hours trapped inside their tent. We're en route to our next campsite, which is called Watson's Place. It's named after a guy who used to grow sugarcane and other crops there. And a lot of people said he was a pretty nice guy. It's just that he had a little problem when it came to murdering people. In fact, they found over 50 human remains on his property once his dirty little secret got out. And today, that property, which is where we're camping, is said to be haunted not only by those 50 plus victims, but by Mr. Watson himself.
News of Bloody Ed Watson's nefarious activities eventually leaked out, and he was confronted by a rather angry mob outside the Smallwood store on Chokoloskee Island. Things turned nasty quickly, and Mr. Watson was gunned down in a hail of bullets. Thus ended the reign of Florida's most prolific serial killer.
Nowadays, the old 35-acre farm is heavily overgrown, with vegetation concealing much of the rusty old equipment, including an old motor car, concrete cistern, and a cauldron used to procure the cane syrup. Watson's Place is one of the other types of campsites in the Everglades, called a ground site. These sites are few and far between, as the low elevation throughout the park means the majority of these locations are heavily overgrown and swampy. We find Watson's to be very well occupied.
We've arrived at Watson's Place, which is a mosquito-infested patch of land in the jungle. To add to our woes, there's ticks here as well. There's a party of motorboaters have arrived. It's become a mini metropolis. And the presence of generators and empty booze cans means there could be a wild night ahead.
Habitats suitable for humans may be a bit scarce, but that doesn't necessarily apply to other species. The Everglades supports a high density of invasive plants and animals. And though he's cute, the anole is one of these. These lizards are native to Cuba and the Bahamas, and males display using a colorful throat pouch.
Birds are also plentiful, although not always conspicuous in the thick bush. A female yellow-rumped warbler inspects crevices in the bark for morsels. Similar habits are shared by the aptly named black-and-white warbler. The red-bellied woodpecker is a handsome and easily seen resident. Catbirds are a bit like campsite managers, and always on duty. The turkey vulture surveys his domain, hoping you might suddenly die. We see here the softer side of the black vulture.
Those cardinals are quite big for a finch. Bird watchers are quite nerdy people. Avid twitchers will even admit that fact. But a word of warning to the uninitiated. Bird watching is a highly addictive activity. It's the crack cocaine of the healthy hobby world. You could be a booze-drinking football fan and in the blink of an eye be able to spot the difference between a mallard and a teal. Ducks.
I get cooking well before dark just to avoid the inevitable attack by the mosquitoes when our neighbors return from fishing. That's when things start to get rowdy. Navigating this twisted maze of channels can quickly become a navigational nightmare. The low point of view from water level, combined with the fact that there's very few conspicuous natural landmarks, make it that much more of a challenge. Trying to paddle this route with just a map and a compass would be a magnificent feat.
For us mere mortals, a GPS with detailed 24K maps and a pre-planned route is a big help. In addition to the aforementioned backup devices, I'm also using a fantastic app on my iPhone called Skipper. It works without cell reception, which is pretty good since there isn't any out here, and it lets me either pre-map my route or change it in the moment if need be. And of course, you're going to need a tried and trusted pair of solar panels to keep all these gadgets charged up. Clinging to the mangroves and gumbo limbo trees are spiky-looking little clumps called bromelades. These plants are not parasitic at all and simply use their host tree for a lift up to the sunlight. These attractive little plants hold moisture after the rains, which can attract creatures, and then can become a place for birds, such as these crows, to visit for a banquet. Our journey takes us off the beaten path of the Wilderness Waterway and farther inland. The water begins to clear a little and even becomes fresh enough to purify for cooking and hot drinks. Up here, the rivers are not so much influenced by the tides that stir up sediment. Instead, the tea color is from vegetation-derived tannins. The water is colored, but still clear enough to offer a glimpse of chunky crabs and schools of smallish fish that I believe could be mangrove snapper. They're apparently good eating. A shallow creek allows for a sneaky dip without too much fear of being eaten or maimed.
Not so much farther inland from here are the sawgrass flats, the stereotypical image one conjures up when thinking of the Everglades. Shallow, swampy fields of sedge as far as the eye can see. Relying on these waters are Florida garfish, introduced tilapia, and huge snapping turtles. The sedge grass is also good nesting grounds for alligators. These little chaps are most likely still under the protection of their mother, who is doubtless not far away. Presently, they will feed mainly on invertebrates, but will soon add just about everything to their menu, including mammals.
Bird life throughout the Everglades is superb. Little blue herons hunt for whatever they can catch. They're small compared to their gargantuan cousin, the great blue heron. Back in the early part of the 20th century, plume hunting was a huge trade that supplied feathers for the ornate hats that were the fashion of the day. Egret feathers were one such prize, and it was guesstimated over 95% of Florida's shorebirds were decimated by greedy poachers.
Amongst all this are groves of cypress pines and accompanying scrub. Giant pileated woodpeckers drum the wood as a territorial display. Mockingbirds hop about their home range, a resourceful little creature with a varied diet. The eastern towhee is a glorified sparrow, and up high, watching over all, is the giant horned owl.
We arrive at Willy Willy Camp to find it Willy Willy crowded. The current occupants have spread themselves out nicely, leaving us a small, damp patch of earth to set up our humble abode, watched over by the resident catbird. From the way the chairs are set up, it looks like our neighbors are poised to watch us sleep.
Although Willy Willy Camp is a ground site, it differs to Watson's in being made from a huge midden of shells, raising it above inundation level. These are historically important sites created by the original inhabitants of the Everglades thousands of years ago. The fierce Calusa Indians were eventually decimated by European diseases, and their weakened population either fled or became absorbed by newcomers. When the occupants arrive back at camp, they reveal they have plans for the mud patch our tent occupies.
Foreman and Wilms travel log, day 4. We're at Willy Willy Camp. We've been relocated out into the mosquito-infested swamps to the woodlands behind the tent because they want to light an illegal fire there.
Clean it up, Dad. I was just making sure you weren't going to hang over the tree somewhere. You
And if we think we've endured the worst, then fate proves otherwise as darkness envelops the camp. Only two thin sheets of fabric and a foot of space separates us from this horribleness. Foreman and Wilms travelogue for day 6. Today has the potential to be kind of a tricky day because we're going to attempt the Wood River. It's a narrow river that's usually grown over with vines and mangroves. It's definitely inaccessible to power boaters, and we're hoping it's going to be accessible to us. On top of that, we're going to head up the Gulf Coast to Highland Beach, which at low tide is also somewhat inaccessible. So there's going to be some interesting
The Wood River starts off quite civilized. It's a lovely little channel protected from the increasingly windier conditions. Yet over the next mile or so, it begins to close in under a canopy of twisted mangroves. The mozzies become active in the gloom, and the water takes on a sulfuric stench. Soon we find out what many dread, and why the Wood River is rarely traveled.
Farther along the river, fallen trees and blockages become so severe that access is denied. The saw on the Leatherman becomes a necessary tool.
On the rare occasion, we find little openings where birds are abundant and large fish rise to the surface. It's an opportunity too hard to resist. Yet the slimy buggers don't seem to want anything I have to offer. No surprise there.
The 8-mile journey on the Wood River takes us an exhausting 6 hours.
We've just busted through the Wood River, near the end. With the wind and the tide at our backs, let's make use of it.
Our destination is the one night we intend on spending on the exposed coast of the Gulf of Mexico at Highland Beach. Our arrival is barely in time as the outgoing tide leaves us with no water. For the last few hundred yards, it becomes so shallow, the canoe needs to be evacuated and pushed. One of the many perils to face here are the vast mudflats, leaving the unfortunate stranded in shin-deep, sticky, and foul mud. Our arrival only minutes later would have been very bad.
This is the third type of campsite in the Everglades, called a beach site, and the only one where fires are legal. They are also very buggy. Mozzies, although ferocious, are not the main enemy. Here is the domain of the no-see-em, a dreadful, minute monstrosity with no regard for insect repellent or respect for any other life form.
It's 8:30 in the morning, and this is all that is left of Highland Beach. Slimy, sticky mud flats. We're going to be stranded here until the tide makes its way in. Then it's going to be a mad dash back up into the broad river where we begin our journey into the nightmare, a narrow, twisting channel that links the northern section of the Everglades with the south.
The tide seems to take its time getting in.
When we finally make it to the nightmare, we find it to be relatively civilized compared to the Wood River route. The fact it receives more traffic keeps it accessible. The main hazard here is water level. At low tide, you could find yourself stranded in mud and a sitting duck to the more than friendly mosquito population. Against all expectations, it's not the nightmare that's so much of a challenge, but the broad river creek that adjoins it. Some kayakers we encountered had turned back here, thinking that the way was completely blocked, and we can't blame them for that assessment. Once through the tangled web, we're back out in the main river system. The wind has picked up and is now howling head-on at 15 to 25 knots, making progress extremely difficult. Yet the worst is still ahead of us.
Whitewater Bay is not named for water clarity, but the whitecaps, often whipped up by the strong winds. The gusts are now hitting us head-on at 35 knots with some formidable waves that threaten to swamp our low-sided canoe. It's vital to keep the bow facing into the waves, but we find ourselves making no progress and at risk of being sunk. With over a mile of open wild water ahead of us, we declare a retreat after less than 100 yards.
Several hours later, attempt two also fails, and we find ourselves back behind the mangroves where we're discovered by a ranger's boat. John and Donna are volunteer rangers out rescuing stranded boaters and paddlers, well aware that in these winds, folks may be unable to reach their destinations.
Our effects and canoe are all loaded onto their vessel, and we begin a 3-mile journey to our chickie for the night. Being rescued from behind the mangroves is certainly a much better alternative than being rescued from a sunken canoe. I found swallowing my pride quite easy, and the boat ride was fun. John and Donna drop us off at the North River chickie as the winds continue to howl. We have time to kill, so I'm going to show you guys how to cast with a stumpy rod.
The winds carry on until 9 p.m. that night before dying off. Then, the mosquitoes move in. The following morning, we meet Donna and John again. Their job today is in regard to a grisly find of 2 dead manatees. Both are in very different levels of decay, yet in close proximity. The task ahead of the husband and wife team is to secure the carcasses.
Donna is completely fearless, so she is commissioned the job of wading into the alligator-infested waters to wrestle with half a ton of festering rotten meat. The wind is back earlier than expected, making life difficult for everyone involved, including some very upset vultures.
Manatees are huge seagrass-eating mammals that enjoy warm waters. They have a human's lifespan, so it's unlikely that old age has killed 2 in the same place. These gentle Sirenians are highly susceptible to being hit and killed by fast-moving boats, as they're nearly impossible to be seen below the surface of the water.
Once the last dead manatee is secured, we travel upstream a short way to where John and Donna have their houseboat, and Summer enjoys a beer for breakfast. Then it's time to bid farewell to our gracious and interesting hosts and head for our last chickie on the Roberts River. This acquisition is a spotted sea trout. They've got to be between 15 and 20 inches. They're good eating, and in Florida, you'll need a fishing license to catch them.
From Roberts River Chickie to Flamingo, we have no choice but to once again brave Whitewater Bay. The winds are not letting up, which means that we're likely to find ourselves in a lot of trouble if we don't do this just right. So, we must make a plan.
The outpost of Flamingo is small, but it's got just about everything. A store, park headquarters, visitor center, canoe hire, boat tours, fuel, and access to both inland and coastal waterways. Not a bad place to finish an expedition.
After a very cunning plan on our behalf to leave the chickie at 2:30 in the morning and travel while the winds were light, we have arrived safe and sound in Flamingo. And that's a good thing because a veritable hurricane is sweeping through the place at the moment. It would have been a very difficult paddle indeed. But we are here, all is good. Journey concludes.
The Everglades is a truly hostile, horrible, and extremely awe-inspiring environment. It is more than the crown jewel of Florida, possibly even more than a national treasure. This massive swamp is not impervious to threats, however, most of which can be traced back to human activity. The burden of protecting this magnificent place is too much for any one government organisation. It is one we all should share to ensure the Everglades stays wild and wonderful for years to come.
Thanks for checking out the Everglades with us. Now, in the future, we will be exploring plenty of other wild and unique places, by Land Rover, by foot, by boat, whatever it takes to get us out into the remote and fascinating parts of this amazing planet. We still have several more Western Walkabout episodes soon to come, as well as other adventures that we're planning to pursue. Now, if you're considering planning a similar trip to this or any of the other excursions that we've brought you, additional logistical information can be found at foremanandwilmsadventures.com. Also, you can find photos and updates on our Facebook site. We would love to see you there. Till next time!